3 years after Einstein published his paper on special relativity, his former teacher, Hermann Minkowski, forever transformed our view of the universe. Einstein had predicted length contraction and time dilation, but Minkowski drew out other radical implications. As the famous quotation above suggests, Minkowski showed that space and time were mixed together in a sort of union. We do not live in a three-dimensional universe with time flowing through. Instead, we live in a four-dimensional space-time. Time is the fourth dimension. These are strange claims. To assess them, we need to lay out some important philosophical issues in general terms. Is the world made of events? A tennis ball is real. A tennis court and tennis players are real. But is a tennis match real? Common sense and philosophers like Aristotle assert that the basic things in the universe are ordinary objects, like human beings, tennis balls, and trees. Modern science disagrees and says instead that atoms or quarks are basic. Human beings and tennis balls are built up from these smaller particles. Both of these views, however, are examples of ontologies in which the basic objects persist through time. That is, a tennis ball or an atom exists at one moment and the next and the next. Loosely put, one and the same object moves through time. Some physicists and philosophers think that relativity has definitively shown that our world does not consist of persistent objects. There are no such things. Tennis balls and tennis courts are not real. Instead, the basic objects are events like tennis matches, elections, or weddings. These are fixed at a particular time and place, and never occur at another time and place. These are the basic objects of an event ontology. According to this view, the ordinary objects that appear to persist through time are really just collections of events. We see a tennis racket striking a ball in flight, a ball nipping a net, a ball skidding on a court, and a ball hitting the opponent's racket. This sequence of events is usually believed to involve one and the same ball. But in an event ontology, these events are each real and distinct. Events are not made up of persisting objects. There is no single ball moving through the events. Rather, there is a similar-looking yellow fuzzy patch in each of a series of events. Philosophers usually distinguish between persistence and endurance. An object that moves through time from one moment to the next persists. A sequence of similar but distinct events that creates the illusion of persistence is called an enduring object. Events are sometimes thought of as parts of the enduring object, which is itself just a long-lasting event. In debates over relativity, an enduring object is sometimes called a space-time worm because it is a consecutive series of events snaking through space and time. Thus, In an event ontology, both people and quarks are reinterpreted as spacetime worms. Compare this to a reel of film shown in the cinema. Each still photograph on the reel is the picture of an event at a particular time and place. The photographs do not change, but the sequence creates the illusion of motion. An event ontology is similar. In reality, there are only unchanging events in fixed sequences, and therefore, the illusion of motion, change, and persistence through time. But surely we experience motion and change. We see it all around us. Defenders of event ontologies agree that we have an illusion of movement and change, but deny their actual existence. The sensation of movement that we might experience in a moving car is just that, a sensation. It occurs at an instant in our minds and is not itself direct evidence for motion outside our minds. Even common sense agrees that there can be sensations of motion without real motion, as when someone is sick with vertigo. Likewise, defenders of event ontologies argue that, strictly speaking, we do not in fact see motion. We see an object at one place and have a memory of a similar object in another place. The visual image and the memory together, they argue, produce an impression of motion. The existence of the memory is a fact about the present, and not itself direct evidence for true motion. Moreover, since motion occurs across time, we could not experience it directly. That would imply experiencing a past moment in the present. In short, defenders of an event ontology say that all experience occurs at a moment in time, and such experience cannot be direct evidence for motions and changes that stretch out through many moments. Thus, an event ontology is compatible with all our direct experience, and therefore strictly in accordance with all observation and experiment. Some philosophers criticize event ontologies, saying that they make the similarity of events in a sequence an incredible accident. Why should the event of the racket striking the ball be followed by another event that includes the ball? This makes sense if the ball moves through time to the next event. But if there is no true movement and change, why should consecutive events be similar at all? Could a ball at one moment be followed in the next by a swallow in mid-flight? Why do we not see series of events that look like cuts in a film, in which the scene changes instantly and there is no relation between consecutive stills? The answer to this objection is interesting. Defenders of event ontologies admit that the similarity of events that follow one another has no physical explanation. It is just a brute fact about which nothing more can be said. Perhaps God just decreed that events have a pleasing order. But, the defenders continue, in the common sense universe, where objects are supposed to be real and persist through time, there is a corresponding mystery. Physical laws account for movement through time, and these are also just brute facts. Thus, both views have to accept unexplainable brute facts. In an event ontology, there is no explanation for similarities among sequences of events. In a common-sense universe, the movements of persistent objects are explained by laws. But these laws themselves, at some level, have no explanation. Thus, in both, there remains a mystery about the nature of movement and change. Moreover, some philosophers say that such laws are just regular patterns of events, which would make the mystery of laws identical to the brute mystery of ordered events. In short, event ontologies seem peculiar, but are surprisingly coherent and compatible with all our experience. Does relativity theory decide the question of whether persistent objects or events are real? Do the future and past exist now? Most of us believe that only the present exists. Events in the future will exist, and events in the past did exist. But neither future nor past events exist now. This view is called presentism, and treats time and space in very different ways. The different parts of space all coexist in a present moment, but only one part of time exists, namely the present. Presentism is compatible with either the existence of persistent objects moving through time or with an event ontology. A presentist merely insists that only the present exists now, and is indifferent to what the present consists of, that is, whether it is persistent objects or events. Many interpreters of relativity have asserted that the theory proves that presentism is false. Instead, the past and future coexist with the present and are just as real as the present. This is strange, and perhaps even frightening. It means that past wars are still being fought, and that every step of our future lives is already happening in some sense. In debates over relativity theory, such a world is called the block universe, because the entire four-dimensional universe, including the past and the future, seems to be like a giant block of ice. All events in the past, present, and future coexist and are frozen in their locations in space and time. For our purposes, we will assume that either presentism or the block universe view must be true. That is, other combinations, like an existent present and past, but non-existent future, will be ignored. Metaphors are often used to help us mentally picture a block universe. It has been compared to a loaf of bread or bologna. The present moment is a slice across the middle of the loaf. The future and the past lie on either side. Of course, the loaf is only a three-dimensional object, and the block universe is four-dimensional. Thus, slices of the block universe would each be a three-dimensional world at an instant, just like the world we see around us now. The series of such three-dimensional slices, past, present, and future, together make up the whole four-dimensional block. Since each slice of the block universe is a complete world at an instant, it contains all objects that exist at the time. This is, again, like cinema film. Each still photograph in the film is a picture of a scene at an instant, and the sequence of all the stills makes up the entire film. If the still photographs were cut apart and bundled together in a pile, we would have yet another image of the block universe. If it is true that we live in a block universe, then there are no objects persisting through time. That is, a block universe implies an event ontology. This is because there is no real motion or change in a block universe. True motion occurs when a body now in one place occupies another place in the future. That is, when one and the same body moves from one location to another as, for example, when someone walks across a room. This could not happen in a block universe where future events already exist. In a block universe, future events have an existence that is just as real and full-blooded as present events. Advocates of the block universe also claim that the movements and changes we see around us are all a kind of illusion. The star of a film may occur in every still on the reel and may appear to be moving when the film is shown, but actually does not move at all. Each still is fixed. Similarly, the slices in a block universe are each slightly different. If we believe that someone is walking across the room, there is actually a series of slices, each with a walker in slightly different positions. In each slice, the walker is standing stock still like a sentry. Thus, both the event ontology view and the block universe view assert that motion is just a series of fixed events, like a sequence of still photographs. In the block universe, all the events in the series exist at once, from the past to the present and into the future. When discussing the block universe or event ontologies, philosophers sometimes find it awkward to use expressions like "the past exists now," or "the future has already happened." The reason is that verbs like "to exist" include a reference to the passage of time. That is, they are past, present, or future tense. Thus, to say "the past exists" seems like a contradiction because the verb is in the present tense. To avoid this, philosophers tend to talk about tenseless existence, that is, a way of existing that does not imply a flow from the past into the future, but is instead eternally static. Thus, they say that, in a block universe, the past and the future exist tenselessly and mean that "exist" here is not to be understood as a verb in the ordinary present tense. A final distinction that is important for understanding the block universe view is that between Laplacian determinism and fatalism, Laplacian determinism, the view that conditions at the present moment, together with physical laws, determine all future events. That is, laws ensure that the future can happen in only one way. Fatalism, the view that all future events are fixed, but not necessarily by physical laws. That is, the future can happen in only one way, but there may be no regular or law-like patterns in future events. Perhaps God or fortune has decreed that a series of miracles or physically uncaused events come about. The block universe view is fatalistic. In a block universe, there can only be one future because it is already there, and in some sense has already happened. But the block universe view does not depend on the existence of laws or any regularities between slices. Laplacian determinism may be true in a block universe or may not be. It was believed that classical physics before Einstein provided evidence for the truth of Laplacian determinism, but many now believe that 20th century physics disproved this view and showed that there is true randomness in microscopic events. The defeat of Laplacian determinism, however, would not count against the block universe view. Thus, the block universe view is compatible with probabilistic interpretations of quantum theory. Upon giving up the hypothesis of the invariant and absolute character of time, particularly that of simultaneity, the four-dimensionality of the time-space concept was immediately recognized. It is neither the point in space nor the instant in time at which something happens that has physical reality, but only the event itself. There is no absolute relation in space and no absolute relation in time between two events. But there is an absolute relation in space and time. Upon this depends the great advance in method which the theory of relativity owes to Minkowski. Albert Einstein, meaning of relativity. Before relativity, it was thought that the world and objects in it were all three-dimensional. This meant everything had a length, breadth, and height. It is hard to say what a dimension is. We picture a dimension as a long, straight line. If three straight lines can be drawn at right angles to each other, the space they are drawn in is three-dimensional. On a piece of paper, only two straight lines can be drawn at right angles, so the paper is two-dimensional. Lines through space can be used to name the locations of objects. On the two-dimensional surface of the Earth, places can be located by their latitude and longitude. In three-dimensional space, we can name places using the three coordinates, x, y, z. What would it mean to say that the world is really four-dimensional? It is easy to locate all events in space and time because each has a place and a date. Each event could therefore be given four coordinates, x, y, z, t. In effect, we routinely recognize that events have four dimensions when we agree to meet someone for coffee at a certain place and time. Thus, it is true, but trivial, to say that events have four coordinates. When some physicists say the world is four-dimensional, they are making a different and much stronger statement. To understand their claim, we begin with a fact and then consider its interpretation. Suppose there are two events, A and B, each at a different place and time. Using rulers and clocks, we could measure the distance between the two places and the duration between the two times. These two numbers indicate how separated the events are in space and time. But as we have seen, these distances and durations are not invariant, and therefore are not real properties of anything. Now, something magical happens. Although neither the distance nor the duration is invariant, together they do form an invariant number. They are combined using a peculiar recipe. The distance and duration are treated as if they were two sides of a right-angled triangle. Using a formula very similar to Pythagoras' theorem, we calculate the length of the third side of the triangle. The new number is invariant. Since it is some kind of combination of space and time, it is called the space-time interval. Measurements of distances and durations depend on speeds, since they will contract or dilate, but the space-time interval between two particular events is always the same. Everyone who measures and calculates will find the same number. This is surprising. How do two variable numbers combine into a constant? One way of thinking of it is that at higher speeds, the lengths shrink and the times elongate, and these variations compensate for each other. All physicists agree that the invariance of space-time intervals is a fact. That is just a statement about numbers that we calculate from measurements. But what does it imply about reality? How should we interpret that invariance? But what does this imply about reality? How should we interpret that invariance? As we have seen, the mainstream interpretation of relativity denies the existence of real distances and durations. They are not real properties of individuals. This is, however, a purely negative doctrine. But clearly, things are separated from each other in space as well as in time. What are they separated by? The mainstream physicist answers that while neither space nor time exists in its own right, the combination of them does. Things are separated from each other by stretches of space-time. The central argument for the reality of the space-time interval was made by Hermann Minkowski. In essence, he argued that if all measurements give the same value for a property, then the property must be real. If there were a painting so beautiful that everyone fell down instantly babbling about its beauty, then we would conclude that beauty really was a property of the painting. Likewise, Minkowski argues that if the space-time interval appears the same in all measurements, then it must be real. It is now clear that the mainstream interpretation denies three-dimensional distances and durations, which are not real properties of individual things, but affirms the existence of four-dimensional space-time intervals, which are real properties of events. Minkowski helped clarify the meaning of the space-time interval with his well-known rotation analogy. Consider some three-dimensional object, such as a sculpture of Venus. As we view it from different angles, its width may change. It may seem wide when viewed from the front, but seem narrow when viewed from the side. Minkowski said that space-time is real, but the different sets of rulers and clocks are all viewing it from different perspectives. According to one set, a space-time interval may appear short in space and long in time, but another set may find it long in space and short in time. More crudely, it might be said that when we treat distances and durations independently, we are arbitrarily chopping up a space-time interval into so much space and so much time. Another observer may choose to chop it up differently into less space and more time. This rotation analogy also explains what it means to say that distances and durations are relations. Suppose that the sculpture of Venus sits in a space and that we choose three lines in the space to be the mutually perpendicular x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis. Given these lines, we can say the sculpture has, say, a length of 2 meters along the x-axis and 3 meters along the y-axis. But these lengths are relations between the three-dimensional shape of the statue and certain lines. If we choose different lines to be our axes, then the length along the x-axis would change. In short, length along the x-axis is not a property that depends only on the individual statue. It is a relation between the statue and a direction. Likewise, the mainstream interpretation asserts that four-dimensional shapes and intervals are real. Choosing an x-axis in space and a time axis defines the distance and duration of a four-dimensional shape, an event. But if the directions of these axes change, then the distance and duration change. They are relations between the four-dimensional shape and certain directions. Space-time intervals may also be helpfully interpreted as sizes of events. In three-dimensional space, volume is length multiplied by breadth multiplied by height. Likewise, in four-dimensional space, the four-dimensional volume is duration multiplied by length multiplied by breadth multiplied by height. Thus, a tennis match may take 3 hours and fill a tennis court, and we can calculate the four-dimensional volume of this event. This region of space-time has an invariant volume, even though the length of the court and the duration of the match are relative to the clocks and rulers used to measure them. Einstein always insisted on the first two ideas, and later accepted Minkowski's interpretation of the space-time interval. The minority interpretation accepts, of course, the fact that the space-time interval is invariant, but it interprets it as a mathematical accident. Movement through the ether causes lengths to contract and clocks to slow. Since these two processes have opposite effects, we should not be surprised that if we combine both in a calculation, they cancel and leave a constant. Lorentz never thought that the invariance of the space-time interval was important. Some physicists believe that relativity theory has proved that the past and future exist in a giant four-dimensional block universe. Although his views changed during his career, Einstein, for example, made the following statement in 1952, a few years before he died. He argued that the relativity of simultaneity implies a block universe. The four-dimensional continuum is now no longer resolvable objectively into slices, all of which contain simultaneous events. Now, loses for the spatially extended world its objective meaning. Since there exist in this four-dimensional structure no longer any slices which represent now objectively, the concepts of happening and becoming are indeed not completely suspended, but yet complicated. It appears, therefore, more natural to think of physical reality as a four-dimensional existence instead of, as hitherto, the evolution of a three-dimensional existence. Although his language is cautious here, Einstein's meaning is clear. There is no physical evolution through time, that is, no change or persistence. Instead, a static four-dimensional block exists. He says that becoming is not completely suspended because there is a residue of change in a block universe. Namely, the adjacent static slices differ slightly, and this creates an illusion of becoming and change. It should be emphasized first that most physicists regard the entire issue of the block universe as speculative and simply have no opinion about the matter. For them, it is simply not a scientific question, since we cannot experiment directly on the past and future. However, many physicists, such as Einstein, Hermann Weyl, and others, thought that relativity theory did prove that our world was a block universe. A number of philosophers have also thought so, although there is naturally disagreement in the details of their views. For example, Bertrand Russell and Hilary Putnam have argued that relativity theory implies some kind of block universe. Arguments about the block universe all arise from attempts to interpret the special theory of relativity, and all go beyond Einstein's 1905 theory by adding new premises. In particular, all attempt to say what reality is like if simultaneity is relative. Einstein's theory, on the other hand, does not mention reality. It merely describes relations between measurements, that is, between appearances. Thus, different interpretations of relativity theory will imply different views about the block universe. As pointed out below, the minority interpretation escapes this strange consequence. The quotation from Einstein above contains a short but very powerful argument for the block universe. According to his theory, simultaneity is relative. That means that different sets of rulers and clocks, moving relatively to each other, will find that different sets or different slices of events are simultaneous. In this sense, to say that two distant events are simultaneous is merely a convention or arbitrary agreement and has no physical or objective meaning. If different clocks were chosen, different events would be simultaneous. As Einstein interprets it above, this fact already implies that we live in a block universe. Einstein's friend and colleague at Princeton, the logician Kurt Gödel, filled in more detail in a 1949 essay. According to him, the relativity of simultaneity seems to lead to an unequivocal proof for the view of those philosophers who, like Parmenides, Kant, and modern idealists, such as MacTaggart, deny the objectivity of change and consider change as an illusion or appearance. The argument runs as follows. Change becomes possible only through a lapse of time. The existence of an objective lapse of time, however, means that reality consists of an infinity of layers of now, which come into existence successively. But if simultaneity is relative, reality cannot be split up into such layers in an objectively determined way. Each observer has his own set of nows, and none can claim the prerogative of representing the objective lapse of time. The similarity of this passage to some of Einstein's writings suggests that he and Gödel had been discussing this issue. This short argument turns upon the idea that true physical change implies profound differences between the past, present, and future. During change, one and the same object loses some properties and gains others. It also persists through time, moving from one moment, which ceases to exist, into the next moment. But if simultaneity is human choice, mere agreement about which rulers and clocks to use, then there is no real difference between the present and the past or future. These labels, past, present, and future, are merely human names that reflect no physical difference in the events they describe. The last line means that we live in a block universe. If there is no true change, then any event that ever existed always exists. It cannot change from existent to non-existent. By way of analogy, consider a map of Earth showing the equator. We could travel there and find many physical differences between the northern hemisphere and southern hemisphere on either side of the equator, trade winds in different directions, etc. Likewise, some claim that relativity theory provides a realistic map of our four-dimensional universe. They insist, however, that unlike the equator, its lines of simultaneity correspond to no physical difference in the universe. We find on the four-dimensional map no objective dividing line between the past and the future, and are supposed to believe that no such line exists in nature. In other words, a realistic interpretation of the relativity of simultaneity is incompatible with presentism. The doctrine implies that the present slice of simultaneous events is the only existent slice. The past slices have ceased to exist, and future slices do not yet exist. According to presentism, change is the passing away of one slice and the emergence of the next. But if Einstein's theory is a good map of reality, then there is no physical difference between the present slice of events and past or future slices. In particular, the conventional labels past and future do not imply the physical label non-existent. Much of the literature on the block universe concerns another related argument that involves three events, and therefore can be called the triangle argument. This argument begins with the premise that, since some distant events coexist with me, at least events simultaneous with me at the present moment exist. Solipsism is the belief that only I exist. That is, the universe consists of me and nothing else. All other things and space itself are an illusion of some sort in my mind. Surely, however, we deny solipsism. But then, some other bodies or events must coexist with me. The only question is which events are the coexistent ones. The triangle argument is aimed at those who accept coexistence but will not at first agree that past and future events exist now, and resist attempts to drive them to this conclusion. Suppose, the argument begins, that past and future events do not coexist with me at the present moment. Then, since some events do coexist, It must be simultaneous events that coexist. The argument shows, however, that even this modest beginning leads back to the coexistence of the past and the future, and thus to the block universe. Suppose that there are three events: me now, me tomorrow, and a distant supernova. Suppose that, according to one set of rulers and clocks, me now is simultaneous with the distant supernova, but that, according to a different set of rulers and clocks, me tomorrow is simultaneous with the supernova. This means that the self I am now and feel to be real, me now, coexists with myself tomorrow, me tomorrow, which is just as real. Of course, since we could have chosen any pair of events far away enough from the supernova, the conclusion means that the present and the future coexist, and thus that the entire future and its past coexist. Thus we live in a block universe. Clearly, the first premise, A, is very suspicious. It moves from a conventional label, simultaneous, to an assertion about physical existence. This is precisely the inference that Einstein's theory is supposed to deny. But the only alternative, short of solipsism, is to concede that some events in the past and future do coexist, and the argument is aimed at those who wish to deny this. The fourth line of the argument, premise D, has troubled some critics. It implies that two sets of clocks and rulers, and therefore two definitions of simultaneity, are used. In the context of this argument, however, this is legitimate. Briefly put, premise A says that simultaneity is good evidence for objective existence. Once we know something exists, we are free to use other definitions of simultaneity, and that subjective choice will not affect what objectively exists. Note that the coexistence does not imply simultaneity. Me now and me tomorrow are not simultaneous. The importance of the triangle argument is that it creates an embarrassing dilemma for interpreters of relativity theory. If they deny solipsism, they must agree that some events coexist. But if they deny that the past and future coexist with the present, then all the coexistent events must be in the present. But this minimalist idea, together with the relativity of simultaneity, drives them back to the idea that the past and future coexist. For those who interpret relativity, it seems that there is no middle ground between solipsism and the block universe. Any attempt to restrict robust existence to some single slice of the four-dimensional world is the assertion of some privileged or absolute simultaneity, and is profoundly at odds with the mainstream interpretation of relativity theory. Indeed, one philosopher has argued that relativity theory does imply something very close to solipsism. Howard Stein severely criticized arguments for a block universe and spelled out in detail which events he believes coexist with me now. According to his view, only me now and certain past events coexist. An event in the past coexists with me now if light from the event could reach me, that is, past events that could have causally influenced me still exist. This appears to be a very strange view. Other people do not exist now, but their past selves may exist and therefore coexist with me. Stein's view shows that although relativity theory makes good predictions, it appears to be very difficult to spell out what it implies about the nature of reality. In the end, it is very difficult to interpret the relativity of simultaneity without embracing some form of block universe. If this seems implausible, then there is extra reason to consider the merits of the minority interpretation. According to this, the relativity of simultaneity is mere appearance. In reality, only clocks at rest in the ether show true time and can be used to judge which events are really simultaneous. Thus, Lorentz and other defenders of the minority interpretation can naturally say that only the present is real. The minority interpretation is compatible with presentism.